Hello everybody, welcome to this webinar on the trademark database, TMDB, for summarizing claims called the TMDB Explained. My name is Wim Grielens from IBM and I'm happy to be your speaker for this webinar. The webinar will give an overview of the TMDB system and its functions. Please note that the meeting is being recorded. The recording will be posted on ICANN's website. During the webinar, you can post your questions in the chat window. So on slide 3, let's have a look at the topics we will be covering today. But first of all, please note that today's webinar is targeted at registry operators. A similar session aimed at registrars will be performed in a couple of weeks. The exact timing will be communicated by ICANN. Main topics we will cover today are registering with and configuring the TMDB, testing summarize and claims functions, certifying for production use and certification exemption processes, how to get support, and we will close with a Q&A session. On slide 4, a brief overview of the TMDB role in the GTLD program of ICANN. Two processes are designed to protect trademark rights in the new GTLD domain space. These are the summarize and claims processes. ICANN has designated the setup of a single central trademark database to support the summarize and claims processes. The Trademark Clearinghouse Database, TMDB, serves as the central database to provide information for registries and registrars to support summarize and claims processes, which are designed to protect trademark rights in this new domain space. The TMDB stores validated trademark information from the Trademark Clearinghouse and makes this information available in the summarize and claims functions that TMDB implements. More information on summarize and claims processes is available on ICANN's website, or on the TMCH, the Trademark Clearinghouse website. Please refer to the links on the slide. So, let's briefly review the summarize process on slide 5. The summarize process allows trademark holders and agents that have successfully submitted trademark records to the Trademark Clearinghouse an opportunity to exclusively register domain names derived from the registered and validated mark names contained in the trademark database in a new GTLD during the summarize process, during the summarize period actually that precedes the general availability of the new GTLD to the public. The summarize process also ensures notification of trademark holders or agents of the registration of a domain name matching a label of a registered and validated mark name that is present in the TMDB. This webinar does not have the intention to elaborate in detail on the summarize process. Please refer to ICANN's website for details on the summarize process. The focus on the webinar is on the functions that the TMDB implements. On slide 6, a quick review of the claims process. The claims process ensures that all registrants who want to register a domain name matching a label, including registered and validated abused labels, which correspond to a validated mark record in the Trademark Clearinghouse, are presented with a trademark notice containing information about the mark records. The claims process also ensures that registrants have acknowledged the existing trademark records concerning the desired label prior to the domain name registration. And the claims process also ensures that trademark holders or agents are notified of the registration of a domain name matching a label, including any abused labels, of a registered and validated mark name, which is contained in the TMDB. Again, the webinar does not have the intention to elaborate on the claims process in detail, Details can be found on ITIN's website. The webinar focuses on the claims functions that the TMDB implements. On slide 7, a list of functions which the TMDB system implements. So in support of Sunrise for registries, retrieving SMD revocation list, submitting Sunrise LORDN files, retrieving the corresponding LORDN log files. Registrars are also able to retrieve the SMD revocation list. And in terms of claims functions implemented, for registries, the ability to retrieve the domain name label or DNL list, the ability to submit claims LORDN files, and the ability to retrieve the corresponding LORDN log files. The TMDB system also allows registrars to retrieve the CNIS files. Not shown on the slide is the fact that the TMDB also supports so-called qualified launch programs. More on that later. The current TMDB release implements version 0.9 of the draft TMCH functional specifications as published online. All of above functions are available in production and also available in a TMDB OTNE or test environment. The use of production services requires registriers and registrars to pass a set of tests and certification in OTNE first. We will cover that later on in the webinar. On slide 8, an overview of the steps you will have to undertake before you can use the production TMDB services. First of all, you need to obtain a registration token from ITIN. With that registration token, you can register in the TMDB system. Next, you will have to configure your connections in order to use the TMDB services. Subsequently, you will have to test and validate integration of your systems with the TMDB system. On successful testing, you are expected to notify IBM and ITIN for validation and certification. And on confirmation that tests were indeed successful, you will be able to start using the TMDB services in the production environment. We will talk you through the above in more detail in the webinar. So let's get started with the section on registering with and configuring the TMDB and move directly to the next slide. Let's have a look at the TMDB registration steps on slide 10. In order to set up your TMDB administrator account, several steps are required. You will have to obtain an email from ITIN with the registration token. You will have to register using this token in the TMDB system to obtain a TMDB user account and a temporary password. After you have received a user account and a temporary password, you will have to set up a new password. From that moment onwards, you will have access to the TMDB portal. TMDB registration tokens can be obtained from ITIN. Your final token can be obtained after having signed the registry agreement. We will walk you through the details of the registration steps in the next couple of slides. So the first step of the registration sequence, we're on slide 11 now, is obtaining a registration token from ITIN. In order to obtain a TMDB registration token, you must have entered into a registry agreement with ITIN for operation of a GTLD. As part of the onboarding with ITIN, you will also have to specify the email address which will be used by the TMDB system to send your logon credentials once you start registering with the TMDB system. You will receive a notification from ICANN with your registration token and some instructions. If you think you should have access to the TMDB system and you have not received a registration token, you can contact ICANN Customer Support Center. The email address is mentioned on the slide. So using your registration token, we're on slide 12 now, you can register via the TMDB homepage, which is available either via the link in the notification mail you get from ICANN or directly at https://markdb.org. In order to register, click on the link Start Registration as a Registry. This will open a new page. So on slide 13, after having selected Start Registration as Registry on the TMDB homepage, you will get your first-time registration page. Enter the GTLD name for which you are registering and the related registration token you have received from ICANN. Review and accept the terms and conditions before submitting your registration request. After you submitted your request, we are on slide 14 now, and assuming you entered the correct details, you will get a registration confirmation screen as shown on the slide. You will also receive an email with the actual login details. The next slide shows an example of the registration mail you will get from the TMDB system. The mail contains the following information. We are looking at slide 15 now. A unique user ID, a temporary password, and the link to your login page. You can select the link to access the TMDB system and proceed to the TMDB sign-in. So we're on slide 16 now. Either use the link you received or access the TMDB homepage by typing in the URL, https://markdb.org, and sign in with the credentials, the ID, and the temporary password you received in the mail. After you have successfully logged on to the TMDB web client using your temporary password, you will immediately be asked to set a new password. We're on slide 17 now. The page will also display the password policy rules. We have highlighted them on the next slide. So on slide 18, you have the applicable password policy rules. These are, the password has to be case-sensitive. It must be made up of at least 8 characters. It must contain at least 4 alphabetic characters. It must contain at least 2 non-alphabetic characters. Any character of the password cannot be repeated more than 2 times. And a new password can be used for a period of 91 days. After this period, the user must change it. So we're on slide 19 now. So once you change your password on first login, you will get a welcome screen. You will get this screen on any subsequent login. So we're on slide 20 now, starting the next step being the completion of your TMDB profile pages. So the profile pages allow you to provide point of contact details, and allow you to set IP addresses and passwords for the Sunrise and Claim services. So to access the profile pages, log into the TMDB system and select Profile from the Welcome page. So we're on slide 22 now, which shows the profile pages. The profile pages allow you to complete point of contact information. Note that the point of contact email address is pre-populated from the token list file we get from ICANN and is kept in sync with the entry in the token file we receive from ICANN. The profile page allows you to complete connection settings for production access to Sunrise and Claim services, meaning passwords and IP addresses. Note that the username is allocated by the TMDB system. It also allows you to complete connection settings for test access to Sunrise and Claim services. The profile pages also allow you to change your TMDB administrator password, the one you use to log into the TMDB system. The default profile page that is shown when accessing your profile pages is the one allowing you to define your point of contact information and connection settings for the production Sunrise and Claim service. You can access the other pages via the links at the top of the profile page underneath the welcome page. So let's look at the test settings page on the next couple of slides. So we're on slide 23 now. You are requested to supply two points of contact. So you can either do this on the production settings page or on the test settings page. We are looking currently at the test settings page. The point of contact information is the person to be contacted regarding administrative or general issues. Note that the point of contact email address is pre-populated from the token list file we get from ICANN, and this is also the mail address that will be used in case you request a password reset. The technical point of contact is the person to be contacted by system maintenance or helpdesk personnel regarding technical issues. The point of contact may be the same person as the technical point of contact, so you can enter one person. Click on Submit to save your details. Moving to slide 24. So in order to connect to the Sunrise and Claims services, like the LORDN service or the DNL list service, the following values need to be specified. A password for each service. The passwords can be the same for all of the services. At least one and maximum five IP addresses for each service. Again, these can be the same for each service. Click on the Submit button to save your details. The above can be done for production services as well as for test services. You should at this stage at least configure the details for the OTME or test access. Okay, let's move on to the next section. So at this stage, you should have configured the TMDB system so that you are ready to start testing. Let's take a look at the Sunrise testing first. So on slide 26, ICANN requires registries or registry operators, actually, to go through a TMDB testing and certification process before using production functionality. This testing and certification process is described in the welcome package you will receive or have already received from ICANN when entering a registry agreement. Before you obtain the certification, you should only use the TMDB OT&E or test functions. As a registry operator, you can test each of the functions supported by the TMDB system. You can test Sunrise services, so download SMB revocation lists, upload LORDN Sunrise files, retrieve the related LORDN log files. You can test claim services, being downloading domain name label lists, upload LORDN claim files, retrieve related LORDN log files. And as a registry operator in OT&E, you can also retrieve CNIS files. You are also able to test the qualified launch program functions, being download of Sunrise list file and uploading qualified launch program LORDN files. So let's look at the Sunrise testing in a bit more detail. We're on slide 27 now. So the first Sunrise function you can test is downloading an SMB revocation list. So a test SMB revocation list can be downloaded as well as the corresponding signature file. The URLs are shown on the slide. The validity of the SMB revocation list can be verified by using the signature file and the related public key that is published in the TMDB system. The SMB revocation list is PGP signed by the TMDB with the private key of the TMDB. On slide 28, you see how you can obtain the public key that will allow to validate the signature. So the public key can be downloaded directly from the URL shown, or can be accessed via the TMDB web interface as shown on the right side of the slide. Note that this public key can be used for validation of all downloaded files, except for the CNIS files. So this should allow you to get started with the SMB revocation list download testing and related integration testing of your systems. So moving on to slide 29 now. Okay, we're on slide 29 now. So let's look at the other Sunrise function, the Sunrise LORDN service. As a registry, you may post a Sunrise LORDN file at the URL mentioned on the slide. LORDN log files can be retrieved using the URL provided in the HTTP location header field in the HTTP 202 return code, which is issued if the interface was able to receive the LORDN file and the syntax of the LORDN file is correct. We will elaborate a bit on the LORDN log file when we talk about the claim service. The related LORDN log files will be available within 30 minutes of the LORDN file upload. You must not attempt to retrieve more than once per minute. This should allow you to get interacting with the test Sunrise LORDN service. Please refer to the draft TMCH functional specifications available online for interface behavior details. Okay, we are now ready to start looking at the next section, which is testing claims functions. So moving to slide 31. The first claim function which is available for testing, which we want to look at, is the DNL list service. So the domain name label list service. The slide shows the URLs where the test DNL list and signature file can be downloaded. Like the SMB revocation list, the validity of the DNL list can be verified by a DNL list signature and a public key supplied by the TMDB system. The DNL list is created by the TMDB twice a day and made available at 0 hours and 12 o'clock UTC time from the data which is stored in the TMDB database. Okay, moving on to slide 32 then, which again shows the location from which the public key can be downloaded, either directly from the URL as shown on the slide or via the TMDB web interface. So this should get you started with the DNL list download testing and related integration testing of your systems. Moving to slide 33, while the CNIS service is to be used by registrars to retrieve CNIS files, registry operators have access to the CNIS service in OT&E to facilitate their testing. You can use the lookup keys contained in the DNL list to download the CNIS files. A CNIS file can be downloaded directly via the URL on the right using the lookup key. Let's have a look at the claims LORDN service now. We're on slide 34 now. As a registry, you may post the claims LORDN file at the URL mentioned on the slide. It is important to notice that the claims LORDN file needs to be uploaded to a different location as a Sunrise LORDN file. Please note the URL. Let's have a closer look at the LORDN service and the LORDN log file on the next slides. The topics we'll cover here apply to both the claims as well as the Sunrise LORDN service. So we're on slide 35 now. Once the LORDN file is uploaded, the system is going to verify if its content has the correct syntax. Amongst others, the system will verify that the file has a header consisting of the correct number of fields, the file has the expected column headers, data items are of the correct type, mandatory data items are present. As examples, when the syntax is valid, the file is queued for further processing. If the file is not valid, the system immediately returns a HTTP response with 400 status. The response body will contain all errors detected during the syntax check. The registry operator is expected to correct the reported errors and resubmit the file in such case. Okay. Moving on to slide 36. Once the LORDN file has been successfully uploaded and successfully verified for correct syntax, the system returns a HTTP response with location header containing a URL that should be used to retrieve the corresponding LORDN log file. The unique pieces of information that make each URL distinct are TLD and transaction ID. So the long number between the slash claims and slash result tags in the URL shown on the slide. The log file will be made available within 30 minutes after the LORDN log file upload, so one should not get alarmed if no file is received immediately after the upload. A registry operator should not attempt to retrieve the log file more than once a minute. So moving on to slide 37 then. So LORDN log files are simple text files that contain processing status for the entire LORDN file, as well as for individual labels. The LORDN log file contains a header, which among other information would indicate the processing status, accepted or rejected, and whether any warnings have been detected. Then for each label submitted in the original LORDN file, the log file will contain a line with processing status. So there are three groups of status codes. So status code starting with a 2, a 3, or a 4. Status code 2000 means a line is valid and processed. 2001 means the line is valid, but it's not processed due to one or more errors in other lines. Status code starting with a 3 indicate warnings, that mean the line is processed anyhow, except in cases of duplicates or in case of errors in other lines. Status code starting with a 4 indicate errors, which means that the whole file is rejected. So in case of errors, the entire LORDN file gets rejected, and no lines get processed. It is up to the registry operator in such a case to correct data lines containing errors and resubmit the file. Please refer to ICANN's TMCH functional specification document available online for the exact meaning of different status codes. We have a link at the end of the presentation to this document. So let's move on and talk a bit about the qualified launch program functions. We are on slide 38 now. In support of the qualified launch program, a summarized list can be downloaded. The summarized list contains the labels attributable to summarized eligible rights holders. The qualified launch program is intended to provide a mechanism for registry operators to register a limited number of names to third parties to promote their TLDs prior to the actual sunrise period, while maintaining safeguards against intellectual property infringement. Please refer to ICANN's website for details on the qualified launch program. The same interface as used for the DNL list service allows downloading a summarized list. The validity of the summarized list can be verified by a summarized list signature file and the public key, which is available from the TMDB system as discussed previously. An updated summarized list is published at 0 and 12 hours UTC. The URLs are mentioned on the slide. So moving on to slide 39. So as soon as qualified launch program start and end dates are defined, the registry operator is allowed to upload summarized or claims LORDN files using the LORDN qualified launch program upload interface. The URLs are mentioned on the slide. From a Lordian validation business logic perspective, the qualified launch program period is considered a mix of sunrise and claims period. Registrations of domain names included in the sunrise list require the use of an SMD file. Therefore, the standard sunrise Lordian log file must be used. Registrations of domain names not included in the sunrise list, but included in the domain name label list, require the claims acknowledgement to be received, and therefore the standard claims Lordian file must be used. Okay, so at this stage we are ready to move on to the next section, where we will look at certification and certification exemption. So certification is a prerequisite step before you're able to use the production functions. So let's have a look on slide 41 at the certification tests that the registry operator needs to perform. So you have to download an SMD revocation list, download a DNL list, upload a Sunrise Lordian file with at least three domain names that have been validated using the testing SMDs generated by the Trademark Clearinghouse, and got the result code 2000 meaning OK, and retrieve the related Lordian log file. The same for the claims service. So notification of successful testing has to be submitted to IBM. So on slide 42, you need to notify IBM by submitting a service request to the IBM service desk with a subject clearly stating certification request. In each service request, the GTLD should clearly be included. Within 2 working days, IBM will verify the tests and will grant you the TMDB certification, or will ask you to repeat the tests in case of any errors. Please note that an email from IBM to ICANN with the registry operator in copy confirming successful test completion is the only proof of TMDB certification that is issued. IBM does not provide any other official certificate. In addition, neither IBM nor ICANN grant access to the live environment of the TMDB in terms of providing additional login and passwords, apart from the ones the registry operator has configured by himself. So moving on to slide 43. So after successful completion of TMDB testing, registries can provide notice of their sunrise and claims period using the ICANN portal. A copy of the IBM certification email should be included by the registry in the GTLD startup information. Actual registry provided sunrise and claims start and end dates will then be uploaded to the TMDB system. This will be transmitted to the TMDB by ICANN. No action is required from the registry operator for this upload. Once a registry operator has provided notice of sunrise and claims periods to ICANN's portal and has passed certification, the production environment and production services can be used. Prior to doing so, the registry operator must configure the production settings by logging in the administration interface, switching to the profile pages, and specify the necessary passwords, IP addresses for the production services if this has not been done already. So more information on the testing and certification is available online at the ICANN website. The URLs for the production services are similar to the ones for the test services, but without the test prefix. So let's have a look at certification exemption. We're on slide 44 now. Registry operators handling a multitude of GTLDs under the IKE new GTLD program can request certification exemption. This way, the need of certification of each subsequent GTLD can be eliminated. A certification exemption request can be submitted to the IBM service desk in the same way in which the request for certification is submitted, via email to ikensd@nl.ibm.com, as indicated on the slide. With the addition of the certification exemption request form and copies of three previously granted certifications, only completed filled-in forms will be accepted by IBM. So the form is available from ICANN's website. The registry operator will need to provide the following in the exemption form. Confirm that three or more GTLDs which have successfully been certified in the past. Affirmation that all of the certified GTLDs are operated from the same infrastructure. Affirmation that the same application coding was used for each of the three GTLDs already certified, and an affirmation that all future GTLDs for which the exemption is going to be applied will use the same IP address to connect the TMDB platform and will use the same infrastructure and application code. On slide 45, a few more points regarding the certification exemption. So certification exemption should be requested only once per registry operator. So in the exemption request, you do not have to specify which GTLD it concerns, as the exemption is of a general nature and is granted once and is valid for all future GTLDs operated from the same infrastructure, application code, and connection details as discussed earlier. So on slide 46, let's briefly talk about recertification. So it is required to proactively request recertification of a GTLD if conditions like major code changes in the infrastructure of the registry operator occur. For such cases, the OT&E environment is available to registry operators to execute tests prior to using the production environment. It is strongly recommended that registry operators test any changes within the OT&E and then request recertification review of any existing certifications or certification exemptions. This can be done by submitting a service request with the IBM service desk. In case the TMDB infrastructure or interface undergoes important changes, recertification may also become necessary. On slide 47, we have a reference to detailed information about the certification and exemption process. So information available from ICANN's website. Okay, so let's look at a few more additional topics in the next couple of slides. So on slide 49, the rules which apply to uploading a LORDN file. So based on timers used by the trademark validators and the trademark database system, the recommended maximum frequency to upload LORDN files to the TMDB is every 3 hours. It is also recommended that registry operators try to upload at least 2 LORDN files per day to the PMDB with enough time in between, in order to have time to fix problems reported in the LORDN log file. The registry should upload a LORDN file only when the previous LORDN file has been processed by the TMDB and the related LORDN log file has been downloaded and processed by the registry. On slide 50, some additional points about the DNL list service. So each registry must download at least each day and maximum 2 times a day an updated list of labels submitted to claims. Note that the URL of the interface to retrieve the latest file does not require knowledge of the file name. So the registry accesses these HTTPS URLs with basic authentication, login password. There is also IP source address filtering implemented by the TMDB. This actually applies for all of the services, both in the OT&E environment as well as in the production environment. Okay. So, a few more topics. The first one on the applicable fees. So there are no fees for registrars. There is a startup fee for the registry when the new GTLD contract is signed with ICANN. And then there is a fee per successful matching domain name registration. Note that all of the invoicing is done by ICANN. Okay, moving on to the next section. How to get support. So the key information resources regarding the TMDB Sunrise and Claim Services are listed on this slide. I need to move one slide back, excuse me. So first of all, the draft TMCH functional specification. Then there's the ICANN TMDB web pages, which include the TMDB manuals, the frequently asked questions, process details, for instance about certification, certification exemption, and also contains recorded TMDB webinars at the links as shown on the slide. So this slide deck, including the recording of this webinar, will be posted on the ICANN website. For technical queries, and we're looking at slide 54 now, that are not answered in the published resources, you can contact IBM Service Desk by mail or by phone. See the contact details on the slide. At this stage, we are ready to start the Q&A part of the webinar. Thank you for listening in. If you would want to ask a question, please raise your hand in the webinar or post your question in the webinar chat. We will also switch the audio conference to interactive mode now.
All participants are now in interactive talk mode.
Okay, we have two questions in the chat window. So the first one is whether the fee per successful domain name registration is calculated using the LORDN or using the zone file. That is actually done using the LORDN file. The next question is how extended claim service is offered by the TMCH going to be supported if registry is no longer sent to LORDN after the 90-day required period.
This is done based on zone files, so not on LORDN files.
Are there any additional questions at this moment? Okay, we have a couple of questions about posting the presentation and the webinar recording. So both the presentation as well as the webinar recording will be posted on ICANN's website. We expect that this will be done in a couple of days. In terms of publishing or registrar-specific information, there will be an additional webinar conducted in a few weeks' time, which is specifically focused at registrars. We don't have the exact date yet, but that date will be communicated by ICANN, and we are working with ICANN to actually fix such a date. We don't appear to have any additional questions at this moment. We will leave the audio conference open in interactive mode and the webinar open as well for the next 10 minutes at least. So if there are any additional questions, please feel free to raise them. Okay. Thanks everyone for participating in the webinar. We will be closing the webinar now, and we will be closing the call as well. Thanks again for participating. Bye.